I hate theater. Well, it's so disappointing, isn't it? You know what I do when I'm sitting in a darkened theater, waiting for the curtain to rise? I pray. Dear God, please let it be a good show, and let it be short. Oh, dear Lord, in heaven, please. 2 hours is fine. 3 hours is way too much. And keep the actors out of the audience. I didn't pay $10 to have the fourth ball come crashing down around my ears. I just want a story. I just want a few good songs to take me away. I just want to be entertained. I mean, isn't that the point? Amen. You know, there was a time when people sat in darkened theaters and thought to themselves, I wonder what George and Ira have got for me tonight. Or maybe, can Cole Porter pull it off again? Now it's just, please, Elton John. Must we continue this charade? It used to be, sitting there in the dark, you knew that when the lights came up, you'd be taken to another world, a world full of color and music and glamour. And then you thought to yourself, I wonder when they're going to bring up the lights. Oh. How things have changed. Oh, hi. How are we today? Great. I'm good too. Some of you can tell are a little quiet. I'm feeling a little blue myself. A little anxious for no particular reason. A little sad, I should feel anxious at this age. You know, a little conscious anxiety resulting in non-specific sadness. A state that I call blue. So, whenever I'm feeling this way, blue, I like to listen to my music. So, I was going through my records this morning. Yes, records. And I was about to put on the 1962 soundtrack recording of Meredith Wilson's The Music Man. Oh, see? But then I said, no! Let's have a little treat. Let's disappear for a little while into the decadent world of the 1920s. Where the champagne flowed, where the caviar chilled, and the whole world was a party. For the wealthy, anyway. So, what did I find for one of my favorite records of Gable and Stein? The Drowsy Chaperone! It's a two-record set. The lyrics were by Julie Gable. And the music was by Sidney Stein, remember? Well, it's remastered from the original recording made in 1928, with the full show and the original casting, including Beatrice Stockwell as the chaperone! Isn't she elegant? So, would you indulge me? Let me play for you, please. Yeah, good, I was hoping you'd say that. So exciting. hear the static. I love that sound. It's like a time machine starting up. Now, let's visualize. Imagine, if you will. It's November 1928, and you've just arrived at the Morocco Theater in New York. It doesn't exist anymore. They tore it down and replaced it with an enormous hotel. Unforgivable. Anyway, it's very cold outside, and there's a heavy gray sleet falling from the sky. But you came by horse, so it's okay. Oh, I mean, you are actually riding the horse, Billy. Yeah. Isn't this wonderful? It helps if you close your eyes. Overtures. Overtures are out of style now. I miss them. They're like a musical appetizer. Hello, welcome. Your meal will be served shortly. But in the meantime, would you like a musical appetizer? A poo-poo platter of tunes, if you would. Oh! Something new! It sounds like a dance number! Kind of rollicking! Maybe involving pirates! Oh. Don't worry, there are no pirates. Oh, now this is it! The moment you know when the music begins to build, you're only seconds away from being transported!
Yes, madam.
How do I look?
You look radiant, Mrs. Tartanelle.
Oh, I do love this dress so. It never goes out of style.
It's a miracle, madam.
Now, the guests will be arriving shortly.
Yes, madam.
And why are they coming?
For the wedding, madam. You're wearing it, madam.
Oh, 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 silly me. Oh, I do love this dress so. It never goes out of style. Now, when will the guests be arriving?
They will be here shortly, madam.
Oh, I shall go put on my fancy dress.
Oh, Mrs. Tartanelle. Yes, your dress, your fancy dress. It was such a pleasure airing it, restitching and prepare. God bless your dress, it's one fine dress. And I will tell you why you put it on. Wedding bells will ring, wedding bells will chime. Madam, you're the hostess and it's happy wedding time. Wedding bells will ding, wedding bells will dong. Wedding bells will ding-a-ling and we will ding-along. Wedding guests have come.
Wedding guests are here. Wedding guests are out the door as soon as they appear.
Mother to a bridegroom, I'm sure to marry Jane. The star of Phelps has fallen to my love alas. I'm George, his best man, George. I'm modern to be doing what a best man not.
Ah, Mrs. Stockville.
Now, don't worry. I have this whole wedding planned out. The key is organization, see? Each string represents a task yet to be completed.
pay the musicians, yell at the florist, book the minister. This whole wedding's going to run like clockwork.
Hasn't come. Someone isn't here. Where is Janet Van de Graaff, and when will she appear? The left.
I need to lie down. People are exhausting.
What's happening? What's happening? What's happening?
We have a bride, the stage, the love. Her debonair bridegroom, a fairy producer, jovial guest posing as pastry chef, a flicky careen, a lapis lazuli, and an aviator. Oh, and of course my favorite character, the drowsy chaperone. What more do you need for an evening's entertainment?
As best I can. Don't worry, it's not too difficult. All the characters are two-dimensional, and the plot is well warm. So, we get a warm welcome from our love-struck groom.
Well, I just wanted to say thank you all for coming. Now, who would have thought that I, Robert Martin, would be marrying a glamorous showgirl, and that glamorous showgirl would be giving up a successful career for me, Robert Martin. I tell you, I must be some lucky fella. Oh, now, if it wasn't for Prohibition, I'd say let's raise a glass.
Here, here.
To Janet Van, the most beautiful girl in the world.
Absolutely not!
Excuse me?
Now, George says something that sets the whole convoluted plot in motion. Just a second.
The groom mustn't see his bride on the day of the wedding. It's bad luck!
Oh! Now, that's kind of the whole plot. So in case you missed it, I'll play it for you again. The groom mustn't see his bride on the day of the wedding. It's bad luck.
Oh!
Now, as a story point, it's flimsy. I know. But I love it. God, it's flimsy.
Breakfast will be served in the Arabian room.
Look, you keep Janet away from Robert. You're the chaperone. That's your only job.
Aye, aye, mon capitan.
I shan't lay eyes on you again until we're standing at the altar. How will I survive?
Oh, well, I was going to wait until our wedding night, but here, it's my latest publicity still.
Why? You're even more beautiful in black and white.
Oh, Robert, who's my little monkey?
I am. I'm your little monkey.
Oh, ow, 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 ow.
And so the bride and groom are whisked away, and we turn our attention to the B plot, which involves the producer.
Mr. Peltic!
Getting married and leaving show business?
Mr. Peltic!
So does she know I got obligations?
Mr. Peltic!
What is it, Kitty?
I can be your leading lady. You said it yourself. I'm useless in the chorus.
Kitty, for the last time, you ain't got what it takes.
But I've been taking lessons. Singing, acting, ballet.
Ballet?
Yeah. I'm pretty good, too. Last week, I auditioned for Swanee Lake.
That's Swan Lake.
Oh, no wonder I didn't get a call back.
A little annotation. In real life, Kitty Peltic were a couple. Jack and Sadie Adler. Sadie's talent for playing dim-witted chorus girls came naturally. She was not the sharpest knife in the drawer, but she had a wonderful career on stage. And at this time, the theater was the only place for stupid people to earn a decent living. And this was before television, of course.
Kitty, I don't have time for this.
But before, Mr. Peltic.
Not now.
Perhaps a nice profiteroli.
Boys, I'm not hungry.
Then perhaps we could offer you something else that you want.
Yeah, something that ain't food.
What?
Allow me to elucidate. Although we stand here in the guise of innocent pastry chefs, we are also, and primarily, employees of a certain individual.
A certain individual?
A certain individual who happens to be the largest single investor in Peltic's Follies. He has sent us here as pastry chefs to express his concern about Miss Van de Graaff's impending nuptials. Specifically, that if she gets married and leaves the show, then there ain't no show.
Don't I know you?
No, you don't.
Have you ever spent any time in Toledo?
No. Have you ever spent any time in a coma?
No. But I've got a cousin in Seattle.
Kitty, please. Boys, you tell your boss this wedding is never gonna happen. You have my word.
Oh, we'll take your word, all right.
But to go back on that word would be a recipe for disaster.
Yeah, like making your shortbread too long.
Or turning your upside-down cake right side up.
Or putting cats in a pie. Cat pie. That would taste awful.
Yes. Yes, it would.
So to summarize,
we hope we have made ourselves perfectly clear.
One can only hope.
You biscotti, be kidding me.
A trifle much.
Don't talk with me.
All right. You can drop the pastry chef routine.
Alas,
we ganache.
We're on the lamb.
Lamb's an entree, you macaroon.
The gangsters are played by the vaudeville duo, the Chair Brothers. John and Peter, Chair. Well, They were born Mendel and Abram Moskowitz, but were renamed at Ellis Island by a bored immigration official. They represent the early style of the typical Broadway gangster. You know, wordplay or stylized movements. Really not very intimidating. Unless you find dancers intimidating, which I do, but not for reasons appropriate to this situation.
We'll leave the matter in your hands, Mr. Feltzig. In the meantime, feel free to browse the dessert carousel.
We got a creme brulee that is to die for,
and a peach melba that'll break your kneecaps.
They're gangsters!
You think so?
Yeah, I remember now. They ran a protection racket in my old neighborhood. If you didn't pay up at the end of each month, they'd come by your place and give you a little surprise.
A surprise?
A Toledo surprise.
I never heard of that.
That's because people have heard of it and never heard from it again. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because they're dead.
Yes, I get it. Go powder your face. I've got to stop this wedding. But how? Oh, Lord in heaven, how? How?
I always thought that moment was a little overplayed. So, with the story well on its way, let's go to the groom's room.
Well, say, handsome, show me those pearly whites.
The groom was played by the dashing Percy Hyde. Before he was an actor, he was the all-bright toothpaste man. His fabulous smile adored every tooth. Anyways, all-bright was hugely popular back in 1920 because one of its primary ingredients was sugar. I know, right? It wasn't long before he became a huge matinee idol.
Now let's see. The little rabbit goes around the tree and down the pole. Oh, Robert, you're all thumbs. You're nervous, aren't you? No, I'm not. Yes, you are. Now, don't worry. It's perfectly normal for a groom to be nervous on his wedding day. It is? Of course.
I love Percy Hyman. Some people say he has a toothy model, but to those people I say, shut up.
Can jive when he marches.
I've got to get the ride soon near as a minister. I've got a wedding on my hands.
George, you sound like you've got cold feet.
What do I got?
Tapioca pudding.
No.
Ew, no.
We did another set of those, I might have to tap out.
They'd be playing taps for us on the bugles in no time.
5, 6, 7, 8.
Hyman, a wonderful performer. I recently saw him on the news the other day, celebrating his 100th birthday. To say the years past have taken their toll on him is a grotesque understatement. But they wheeled him out. Oh. And he had this wide-eyed expression of pain, confusion that God reserves for the very, very old on their birthdays. You know, the one that says, "Who are you?" And who am I? And why is this cake on fire?
You know what I'm talking about. Well, anyways,
that's enough of that. Dancing around like a fool.
Well, I'm sorry, George. It is my wedding day, after all.
Well, you could have snapped your ankle. Tap dancing's too dangerous.
Why don't you go out for a skate instead? That's what I do when I want to blow off some steam. Skates? Of course. George! Wait a minute! What was I thinking? You can't go out like that! You might see Jen! Here! Put on this blindfold!
Oh, George, you think of everything!
Just looking out for you, my boy. Now remember, no more tap dancing. You got it!
No. Oh, thanks, buddy.
Just ignore it. It'll stop soon. Just ignore it. What?
Hello. You've reached my answering machine. Leave a short message after the tone, and I'll call you back at my convenience. And I am very likely in, so do not interpret this as an invitation to burgle.
Thank you.
Thank you!
It's like a cell phone going off in the middle of a field. I hate that. Hello, what are you doing? Oh, well, just sitting in the middle of theater, ruining the moment. What about you? Oh, well, I couldn't get out tonight, so I thought I'd ruin the moment by proxy! Sorry. Let's just shake that off. Come on, let's shake that off. Let's go back in our minds to 1928. You know, they didn't have cell phones back in 1928. Well, I'm sure they had something for the ruining of moments. Bugles or something.
I don't know.
is painfully obvious that Miss Vandegraaff has no desire to continue a life on the stage.
Can't you see it's killing us all?
Don't worry, boys, this isn't over yet.
Yeah, I'm surprised she didn't do an encore.
Jane Roberts as the bride. She was billed as the Oops Girl. Remember? Don't you people read? What? She was billed as the girl whose beauty was so great that it caused men all around her to have accidents. You know, spill their drinks or drive their cars into trees. And she would go, I'm not really doing it justice, but people ate it up. She had a whole series of films. She had Oops, the Oops Girl, Oops Girl Come Home, and Oops Girl at Sea, which won an Oscar for special effects. And apparently she had a small role in Tora, 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 but I've never been able to spot her.
Okay. Begging and groveling didn't work. On the plan B. And for that, I'll need an accomplice. Someone gullible with, loose morals. I need a, what do you call him? A European!
Papi, no se toca mi esposa!
In walks Adolfo, self-proclaimed ladies man. And former silent film star, Roman Bartem. He was the one who later died at his chateau in Nice, remember? Well, it was 5 days before his body was found, and by that time, it had been partially consumed by his poops. Well, only partially consumed.
Excuse me, I don't believe we've met.
I am Adolfo.
You are Adolfo?
Yes, I am Adolfo.
Not the Adolfo.
Yes, I am Adolfo.
Funny, you don't look like a scoundrel.
Yes.
What? Why, I just overheard the groom saying that Adolfo was a scoundrel. I just heard him say that.
What? Adolfo is a scoundrel!
Those very words.
Adolfo is a scoundrel!
It's like I'm hearing it again.
This is outrageous! He is saying this to people, stupid!
To beautiful ladies.
Why? I must!
You must take matters into your own hands.
I must take this groom into my hands and kill him.
Yes. No! Don't kill him. Just hurt him enough so he can't get married.
Show me to this groomba. Quick!
What?
What kind of man is this groom? Big man?
Whoa.
Fellow?
Well, he's big on the outside.
No! Adolfo wanna fight big man! Small, pale, wheezy, little dwarf people that Adolfo can punt far away. But no big man!
So, you're a lover, not a fighter?
Yes, Adolfo is a lover of beautiful ladies.
Wait. Like Mrs. Sutton?
Especially Mrs. Sutton! Some say I am the king of romance!
Well, you know what they say. The best way to get revenge on a man is through his...
door!
No. No. The best way to get back at a man is through his...
window!
No! Revenge! Back at a man! Through his...
There is no other way.
I'm not Santa Claus coming down from chimney.
Through his woman!
Through his woman! Show me to this bride! Wait!
What?
What kind of woman is this bride? Big woman?
No!
Pretty woman?
No! She's the cat's pajamas!
What? Pyjamas!
She's a looker, an attractive woman!
Show me do this, Captain! Pyjamas! I will make her purr like a cat in pyjamas!
Ah! Roman Bartelli, chewing the scenery. You couldn't get away with a performance like that nowadays, could you? Well, we as society have grown too sophisticated to enjoy broad racial stereotypes on the stage. So we banished them to Disney. Let the children sort it out.
Oh, in a few short hours, I'm going to be Mrs. Robert Martin. My head is spinning.
Yes, life is a mad one.
Now, this is the only time that Beecher Stockwell and Jane Roberts are alone on stage together. Jane Roberts was an emerging star, but Beatrice Stockwell was already well established and a force to contend.
Oh, I feel such apprehension, but I suppose that's normal, given the circumstance. Chaperone, do you think that Robert is in love with Janet Vandegraff, the girl, or Janet Vandegraff, the sensation? I mean, I'll admit that many have fallen for the latter. Oh, I know you think it's crazy to give up such a successful career to marry a man that I hardly know. But somehow, for some reason, when I look into his eyes, his big monkey eyes, it just gets woozy. And that's what it's about, isn't it? I mean, that's love, isn't it?
Not necessarily. The wooziness can be caused by any number of things. For example, I'm woozy right now. I'm not in love.
Beatrice Stockwell was famous for her rousing anthems. She entertained and inspired the troops with her rousing anthems in every major world conflict, up to and including the Falklands War. Now, by this time, she was in her late 80s, but still, she demanded a rousing anthem in every show she ever did, even if it wasn't appropriate. But you just couldn't say no to her. That's star power.
Really? You're not being the least bit helpful. Couldn't you at least allay my fears with a few choice words of inspiration?
Inspiration? Really, dear, that's not my forte.
Yes, but even...
As we stumble along on life's funny journey, thank you.
chaperone, but I fail to see how it pertains to my situation. Let me explain.
It's a dismal little world in which we live. It can bore you till you've nothing left to give. Seven overrated wonders, seven underwhelming seas, six excruciating continents.
Antarctica. Oh, please.
Still, you mustn't let it let your planet also land. Keep your eyeball on the highball in your hand.
Shoehorn that song into the show. That's what I love about her. She just does whatever she wants, regardless of the needs and concerns of others. My mother was like that.
That was quite inspiring, chaperone. But I'm still conflicted. Please, just tell me, is Robert the man for me?
Why don't you ask him? Why don't you say, Roger, do you love me?
It's Robert.
Right.
Oh, and I'm not allowed to see him. In fact, it's your job to keep me away from him.
Yes, and I take that job very, very seriously. However, I'm just this moment feeling terribly, terribly drowsy. I'm afraid I'll have to have a lie down. Now, whatever you do, don't go wandering through the garden, seeking out your fiancé to ask him the question upon which your future happiness depends. Leave!
Oh, thank you, chaperone! I just have to know if he loves me.
Oh, well, it's wasted on the young. When you're old and know what to do with it, it's nowhere to be found.
Donde está mi amore?
It's Adolfo come to seduce the bride.
I am. Adolfo.
Try not to think of the poodles while you're listening to this.
And you are the bride.
No, I'm not.
What? This is Roger Quick. You are the only one in here. Therefore, you must be right.
Interesting argument, but I'm afraid you are a moron.
What?
Me, no bride. But perhaps I can take a message.
Yes. Very good. Dear Van de Graaff Pride, I must kiss and woo you. Sooner is better. Signed, Al Zarco, King of Romance.
Ah. You've seen through my little ruse, you've found me out.
Ah, so you are the bride.
Apparently, yes.
Let me take you away far from here.
I could do worse. Kiss me, adult face.
No. Now, adult face, adult boy, you must remember my name or it will spoil everything. How can I make you remember?
Mother's favorite number in the show. Yes, I think this was her fantasy. To be swept off her feet by a Latin lover. I mean, a real Latin lover, not a buffoon. But that's what musicals are all about, right? Romantic fantasy, falling in love at the drop of a hat, and spontaneous tangoing. And suddenly finding yourself in a romantic setting, like Mrs. Tottendale's garden.
Oh,
Robert, look out!
Don't worry, madam. I'm getting married today. So I have to wear a blindfold.
A blindfold?
This is a good scene. I'm sorry, I didn't quite catch your name. My name is Robert. Who might you be?
Oh, why, it's me! I mean... Mimi! Mimi from... France.
This scene couldn't be more ridiculous.
Oh, bonjour, Mimi. Comment allez-vous?
Yes, so, tell me more about this woman that you are marrying.
Oh, why, Janet Vandergraaf. Would you like to see your picture?
Oh, yes, please.
Here.
Oh, she is beautiful.
Oh, oui.
And glamorous.
Ah, oui, oui.
Is it true that she excels at playing both dramatic and comedic roles?
C'est vrai. Elle est la plus belle fille de l'amour. Say, I'm having trouble placing your accent. What part of France are you from?
Oh, the middle part. Where they make the toast.
I've been there plenty of times. The toast is quite amazing.
Yes, so tell me more about this woman that you are marrying. How do you say it in English? Your fiancé?
That's right.
Tell me about the moment when you knew that she was the only one for you.
Well, it's a funny story, actually. In English, we have an expression. Falling in love. Well, that's exactly what happened. We were standing on the Lido deck of the Isle de France, and I looked into her eyes, her big, glamorous eyes, and... Well, I fell right on my keister. And that's love, isn't it?
I hope so.
And then, the darndest thing happened. I was so happy that I started singing. There was a time I could stop on a dime. Forbearance was one of my talents. But since you've been around, I can't hold my ground. I'm consistently losing my balance. I'm an accident waiting to happen. I'm a mishap about to ensue. I'm the toy on the stair, the three-legged chair, the hem that's been caught by a shoe. When my two lovesick arms started flapping, there was nothing my ankles could do. I'm an accident waiting to happen, so how may I happen to you?
And then what happened?
Why, she joined in.
Men say I'm sweet, and they fall at my feet. My heart doesn't beat any faster. But when you lose control, it touches my soul. So I'm bracing myself for disaster. You're an accident waiting to happen. A catastrophe destined to be.
I'm the rags in the cellar.
A broken umbrella, a branch hanging loose from the tree. I can see myself jumping and clapping for a man who lives dangerously. You're an accident waiting to happen, so hurry and happen to me. And then what happened?
Well, then we kissed.
You're an accident waiting to happen. So hurry and happen to me. Wait a minute. You kissed a strange French girl on your wedding day.
Oh no! What have
I done?
Oh no. Will everything work out in the end?
Of course it will. It's not even real. It's musical. Everything always works out in musicals. Nothing ever works out in real life, though. And the only people who burst into song are the hopelessly deranged.
Where's that philandering foreigner? How long can it take to seduce one bride?
Oh, what is it now?
I found a replacement for Janet. She's a fabulous new star.
Her name better not be Kitty.
Oh, no. It's Katrina, master of the brain. I've been working on a mind reading act.
Kitty.
Think of a number between 5 and 7.
6.
No.
Kitty!
Wait, let me try another one. Now I'm going to read your thoughts. Don't forget to pick up some milk and bread. Don't forget to shave your legs.
You're reading your own thoughts, you idiot! How many times have I gotta tell you? You gotta have a mind to read one.
Mr. Feltzig,
it would seem that the wedding is proceeding according to schedule.
Why, my partner and I have just finished frosting the third tier of the wedding cake. We have played the fondant
and the little pink rosettes.
Fellas, please, I need more time. Can't you just frost another tear?
There are no tears left.
Save the ones that will soon be emanating from your eyeballs.
Now it's time for you to receive your just desserts. What do you say, partner? Should we whip up something special for Mr. Feltzy?
How about a Toledo surprise?
An inspired choice.
A Toledo surprise? What is that, exactly?
We'll share the recipe with you.
First you chop the nuts.
Then you pound the dough.
Then you bake it up, nice and slow.
Then you got a Toledo.
Toledo surprise!
Could you run that by me again?
It's a very simple recipe, Mr. Feltzig.
First you chop the nuts.
Then you pound the dough.
Then you bake it up, nice and slow.
Then you got a Toledo.
Toledo surprise! Say, why don't we give him a little taste?
All right.
Hold it! What style? What grace? What rhythm? Open your fists. Shake them. Now give me that recipe one more time. Da 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 da. Boom!
Chop the nuts, pound the dough, bake it up nice and slow. Then you got a Toledo. Toledo surprise. Hit the beach, peel the skin, mush it up, throw it in. That's a nice Toledo, Toledo surprise. First you beat it up, then you speed it up. When you heat it up, it starts to rise. Don't let it it's a snap, try it folks. Whip your whites, split your yolks. Then you got a Splendido, Toledo surprise.
Keep it up. I'll go work on the arrangement.
Yay!
A 5, 6, 7, 8.
What's going on here?
Ah, Kitty, I'm working on a new act for the pastry chef.
Toledo surprise.
You put gangsters in the show, but you don't want to eat it. They're not even in the union.
Oh, no, you got it all wrong, Kitty. The new act is for you. And these boys are your backup dancers.
Dancers? Holy cow!
is off.
What? Why?
Bride is no longer in love with Gruma.
That's not the bride, you idiot. That's the chaperone.
What?
The wedding is off.
The wedding is off. Robert kissed a French girl. Her name is Mimi. She's very beautiful.
I couldn't help it, Janet. She was just like you. Only French.
Sweet mother of pearl.
I'm late.
Yes, madam.
What is all this commotion about?
The wedding.
Wedding? Oh, I love a wedding.
Well, I'm afraid it's been called off.
Oh, how terrible.
Yes, what a tragedy. What a wonderful, wonderful tragedy. Clear the floor, boys. I'll show you how it's done. First you beat it up, then you sweet it up. When you heat it up, if it tries to rise, don't let it.
Our dreams are in tatters.
Yes, but the tune is so infectious.